So far, our efforts are to understand language. To understand Verilog HDL, that is language. Once we get this Verilog HDL, once we understand what HDL is and what constructs are there in that, then the other side is we have to model. The other side of the story is we have to start modeling. We have to start modeling. So this modeling could be combinational circuits, or it could be sequential circuits, or it could be FSMs, finite state machines. So, or it could be complex system, or it could be a complex system itself. Complex system means wherein we have these two data path included. And control path included. So we have to get the things. Why the reason for taking up this this portion is this part is so far what we are doing, we are only focusing on Verilog HDL language. We are not focusing on how to model the combinational, though we took up the few examples, though those few examples are not sufficient for the learners there who are attending this class, who are new to this Verilog HDL, those who are already aware, those who are already working, for them it's okay. But those who are not working, those who are studying, are students there. So for them, learning this language is one part of the coin. The other part of the coin is modeling is another part of the coin. So guys, there you please understand, we as a part of learning the language, we also modeled a few examples combinational so far, because we just started sequential behavioral level modeling. So possibly we'll be doing sequential also from today class onwards. My point here is I think you people are understanding what I'm trying to convey. So far, we are trying to understand the Verilog HDL constructs, how we try to model the behavior of the hardware. But we elaboratively several examples of combinational we did not take up. So that is the point we have to remember, we have to understand. So as a part of this modeling, we have to model combinational circuits, we have to model sequential circuits, we have to model finite state machines, we have to model complex systems. Then we say that we mastered Verilog HDL. We mastered digital IC design, digital IC front end. Again, digital IC means again, digital IC only RTL developers. Only RTL, register transfer level. RTL means any code written in a Verilog or any HDL, which is synthesizable, which is acceptable to the synthesizer. So that is RTL. So as a RTL developer, we can say we are good at RTL development. This is only, again, one side of the coin. The other side of the coin here, there are a lot more things here, like, you have to perform static timing analysis, and you have to go here. Several things, your floor planning is there, your placement is there. Your routing is there. So all these issues yet to be discussed. So you just learning a Verilog HDL, what you are doing is, you are trying to reach here this stage, RTL developer stage. So you can say, yes, I am a good RTL developer, if you undergo all this combinational, sequential, FSM, and complex system design, wherein you develop a data path unit, wherein you develop a control path unit, and you combine these two in the top level, and you simulate, functional simulation you perform. So at that time, you can say that you are good at RTL coding. You're good at RTL coding. So these are the other coin, other side of the coin are, these are still yet to learn. So with this said, let us move to today's our topic. Our topic we are discussing last time we started our discussion, behavioral level modeling constructs. Behavioral level modeling constructs we started. So in this, we have been told, we learned that there is the initial and there is a always. Always. These two are procedural constructs. Anything that comes under this procedural construct is a procedural statement. Is a procedural statement. So this part we studied last time, and we also studied that in always is 99% is used, and it is supported by the synthesizers. It is supported by the synthesizers, and 99% it is used in test benches. In test benches. That also we, last time we have seen, because it is mostly not supported by the synthesizer tool, this initial construct. We also said last time what is meant by supported by synthesizer and what is not supported by synthesizer means what. That also we have seen last time. If you have any queries, previously recorded videos, you can refer once. Now, the point here is, while we code this, you know, using always, we have to understand there are two assignment operators. This is today's topic. We are starting today. So in this, we have one is this, the other is less than or equal to. One is this equal symbol, the other is less than or equal to. These two are assignment operators. In behavioral level model, this first one is called blocking assignment operator. This is a non-blocking assignment operator. This is one thing that we have to understand before getting into coding. Assignment operators are two types in a behavioral level model. One is a blocking assignment operator, the other is a non-blocking assignment operator. These two. This is one thing that we have to understand. The other thing that we have to understand, there are two delimiters. There are two delimiters. One is begin and end. The other is fork and join. So these are the two delimiters. These delimiters comes when we have multiple statements. If we have multiple statements, just a moment. If you have here multiple statements, I thought of creating a space, but I couldn't able to. So after always, if you have a statement, let us say A equal to B and C equal to D. So meaning what here, you have one statement is, the other statement is this, second statement. So likewise, if you have multiple statements, this begin and end, begin and end, or fork and join. But fork and join, guys, remember, this is used in only simulation. Only in a simulation. New learners especially understand, while we, you, though delimiters are fork and join, delimiters means this, when we have multiple statements in the procedural construct, we have two procedural constructs, one is always, the other is a initial. in this initial answer, suppose we have, A equal to B again, and C equal to D. How many statements we took here? For example, here, two statements. So just like that initial and these two statements, we cannot write. We have to have begin and end. Then we call delimiters. These delimiters are of two types. One is this, the other is this. One delimiter is begin end, and the second delimiter is fore join. Fore join is used in simulation. Begin and end is used in a RTL code. Begin and end is used in RTL code. From now onwards, we will use RTL code. RTL code means any code that is synthesizable. So that is RTL. So any code that is synthesizable is RTL. In RTL, we use begin and end. We avoid using, we don't use this fork and join. Why this, what is the difference between fork and join? What is the difference between begin and end? That subsequent classes will learn that. But we are just letting you know what all keywords that are there in the behavioral level modeling. So these are the keywords that we have. Now, we talked about this one. This equal to and this less than or equal to. We said that these are assignment operators. These two are assignment operators. These two assignment operators are part of behavioral level modeling. How many assignment operators are there in a behavioral level modeling means there are two types of assignment operators. What are they means? One is equal, the other is less than or equal. What we call this equal means it's a blocking assignment operator. The blocking assignment. Why it is blocking assignment? We will discuss that. This one is called non-blocking assignment. Now, the point that I'm trying to bring here is, in this behavioral level modeling, these two will come. What two will come? Assignment operators. Whereas in a data flow level modeling, we have seen data flow modeling in the previous sessions, we have seen assign y is equal to, if s is true, then b, else a. Now, if you see here in this case, we have this assign one keyword and one assignment operator, this one, that is equal to. That is this equal to. So this assign is one, and this equal to is second, another one. These two are part of this data flow. In data flow level modeling, in data flow level modeling, you cannot use less than or equal to. Like, are you getting the point? Assign y less than or equal to yes. Question mark, if yes true, then assign B, colon, A, semicolon. This is not correct because assign keyword, this is a data flow level modeling wherein you are assigning to Y, right hand side, left hand side, using this operator. This operator is not part of the data flow level. This operator is a part of the behavioral level. This is a part of the behavioral level. And this is also part of the behavioral level model, which is also a part of the data flow level. So with that said, you know, what is the conclusion is, behavioral level modeling, we have two types of assignment operators. In a data flow level modeling, we have only one type of assignment operator, that is only equal. That is the point that we have to remember. Now, let us go to this. What happens if we use this one? Which one? This one. That is the blocking. So let us say we have this one. You have always. Now you are using here hash. Let us not use hash because it, hash is a timing related. We thought of taking time related everything last before we wrap this session. If time is left, then timing issues we can take up, time related constraints. Now A is equal to 3. B is equal to 4. C is equal to, and this is 5. I have to put B in and the other side, I take always begin. Begin. This begin. So this is begin. And what we want to put here is this one. B less than or equal to 4 and C less than or equal to 1. Are the people there? Satish, are you there? I thought, so sometimes it is getting disconnected, so I'm not sure, that's why. Okay. Now, let us put here that hash. Did I put or not? Okay, not to take. Now, what happens is here, first. In this case, this assignment will not happen unless this is not happening. First, it should happen. What is that happen? This assignment should happen. That is, A should get value 3. Value 3. Then only it will go to the next step. Then 4 will be assigned to B. 4 will be assigned to B. And thereafter, this will be assigned. One after another. First this, second this. Unless the first one is not getting executed, the second is not allowed. So this one is blocking. It's sort of blocking. This first statement is blocking the execution of second and third. So that's why the name has come. This is a blocking assignment operator. In this case, what happens is, at a simulation time, given simulation time, all are assigned. This is without blockage here, this is assigned. Now, in a further, in a good way to understand, let me demonstrate with the time. So you will understand in a better way. I have here always. Want to assign here hash 3. This is the time, and then the value that I want to assign is 5. And then B hash 2. And the value that I want to assign is this 7. And then hash 1 or anything that you can give. 10. And here, since multiple statements are there, I'll put here begin and end. Now the other side here, the same here, everything that is always will be there, and the begin will be there, and then this is end, everything same. This everything is same, A, B, C, but only assignment operator. This less than or equal to, less than or equal to. This less than or equal to. The same, this is same. Hash 3, this hash 2, and this is hash 1, and then 10. This is, I had to close, a value I had to give already, right? 5, 7, and this is, what is that? 10. Okay. So, now guys, with this example, I think it is good to understand. We have used here blocking. You see, this assignment operator used is a blocking. So when this 3 comes, simulation time, here we are running the simulation. simulation is proceeding like that, from zero, starting from zero time units, starting from zero time unit. We are saying time unit. Time unit could be femtoseconds, it is microseconds or milliseconds. These are the permissible time units. So now here we are going here somewhere here. We don't know what is the time. So let us say 100. It's the maximum, let us say. So now what happens in this case? Since sequentially these are executed, first one, the one this, and then this, sequentially. So at time 3, where is the time 3? Here, 0, 1, 2, 3. At this, 5 will be assigned. Value to what? Variable A. Now, this is cumulatively added up. This time is cumulatively added up. This is 3 plus 2 is now 5. At 5, this B will get a value 7. That is at where here if you see 3 plus 2, meaning 5 time units. So here we have somewhere 4, here we have 5. At 5, B will get a value 7. Now cumulatively added up, so this is 5 and then this is 6. At 6, C is going to get a value of 10. So at 6, C is going to get a value 10. Now come to this one, the other side. Yeah, let me take the color, different color. At 3, this 5 will be assigned to A. Now no cumulative added up here, because it's a parallel executed. This one, all are parallel execution. So now what happens? At 3, A will get a 5. This is 5, that is good. Now at 2, this B will get a value 7. Here it is 2. So this is a B. B will get a value 7. Now at 1, so C will get a value 10. This 0, 1. This, let us take off this. Okay. Now at 1, what is that? C. C will get a value 10. So this is parallel execution. This is supporting a parallel behavior. What is supporting parallel behavior? This operator is supporting a parallel behavior. It's not blocking the execution of, here we have 1, 2, 3 statements. The first statement is not blocking the execution of the second statement. The second statement is not blocking the execution of first and third statement. No one is blocking actually. Every statement is executed parallel. This power has come because of this operator. Now, in this case, this is actually blocking. First one blocks the execution of the other statement, followed by the first one, whatever the statements are there here, all are blocked till this gets not executed, this first one, and thereafter the second one, till that all executed, all the statement followed by that second all are blocked. So that is because this assignment operator. So this assignment operator is called actually blocking assignment operator. That's why this assignment operator is called blocking assignment operator. This assignment operator is called non-blocking assignment. So is that clear? This understanding, is that clear? This example, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now the question is, we have to understand the usage. All the time we have to link the language learning with the HDL, that is hardware description. So now let us link this usage of this with the hardware. So let us link now. So we have a block like this. This is a, let us say, the combination. This combination of logic there, this is a sequential. So in this combinational block, whatever the inputs here are, this inputs here, these are the primary inputs. Anything, the behavior that changes here, whatever that number of inputs we have here, whenever either one is getting affected or changing, the internal gates or whatever, they perform the required operation and the relevant output is seen on the output. So we know the sequential behavior is not like that. Whenever it changes here, there is the input, let us say D. Whenever input changes, this input behavior cannot be seen on the output. Let us say this is Q. We don't see that behavior instantly like that. Mostly we use this sort of, the moment this comes, it's a edge behavior. We call it as a this portion. Edge behavior. This edge could be a positive or it could be a negative. But point here is the behavior of the sequential mostly, most send percentage. So they are clock based. So this clock based, now if you take this is simple example. This is a simple one and two. But the complex, if you take, in that complex, you have several flip-flops are there. Maybe connected with a common clock. Maybe they are connected with a common clock like that. So now, this common clock is actually driving, this is affecting all these flip-flops here. So, and they may be getting input from different sources. Maybe this may be connected here. This may be possible. Is this one here? The other possibility, maybe they may be taking from here. The other possibility may be from anywhere. This is maybe externally coming. This is maybe externally coming, or from feedback maybe coming to here. That is also possible. Several, depending upon the application. So what is the point that we are trying to make here is this sequential. Most of the time, if you observe the circuits, they behave like a parallel sort of behavior, But when you observe the combinational, so combinational is not a parallel behavior. Combinational is not a parallel behavior because some combinational circuit, if you put here, this is not with respect to the clock. It is whatever the input that is coming, that may be coming from the external, that may be coming from the internal, such as maybe this flip-flop is fed to here maybe, but this is not driven by the clock, and this clock is not driving any other combinational also, because after all the clock concept is not there in the combination. The only inputs drive this circuit. Here, along with the inputs, and there is also something called clock and something called reset, something called preset, everything, other things. Other things are also a part of this network. So, and this network mostly because of complex designs, so not only one or two, several flip-flops will be there, and several flip-flops are driven by the. So, a kind of parallel behavior we can see in a circuits, the so-called circuits called sequential, we see this nature, parallel nature. And we don't see that parallel nature here in the combination circuits. So this is one theoretical discussion. And the practical discussion is theoretical or practical, whatever. The discussion is, this is one discussion. The other discussion is, when we say model, this term, what we mean actually? We mean describe. What you describe, hardware. Where, how you describe, using HDL. Then what is the point of this HDL? This HDL after all used, given to a synthesizer, right? The synthesizer. Then synthesizer is a, what it is? It is a software developed by some people. So what it has to do? It has to do, depending upon the description given by the hardware designer, not a programmer, hardware designer, it should be capable of developing maybe a combinational circuit, maybe sequential circuit, maybe sequential. So who has to tell to the synthesizer, magically nothing going to happen, everything is in human intervention only, human some human developer this software. So meaning what, translating what you have described needs to be translated to maybe combinational, maybe sequential. For example, if you have assign y equal to s question mark b, this is for understanding purpose I'm demonstrating with this example. You have used here assign. Now this is what at the abstract level, right? It's not a hardware, at the abstract level, high level, it's a sort of programming level. So you have written this one. Ultimately, what is expected? This should be giving some hardware to you. It may be a combinational or a sequence. Some hardware it should give. What should give? This piece of statement should give you. Now, this giving of the hardware is by the synthesizer. Synthesizer should translating this one into combinational or sequential. Then how is that possible to the synthesizer to translate this one? Somebody, human has developed this synthesizer. So they developed this EDA vendors, what we call them, this EDA developers, electronic design automation tool developers. They translate such one to the combinational. And some other way, if you code, they translate it to sequential, some other way. What is that some other way and all, we'll see. So these EDA developers, they said, if you use this one, that is translated to combinational circuit. If you follow this set of rules, then that is translated to a sequential circuit. That is what the instructions given by EDA developers. Because since EDA developers have given this set of rules for us, how to use, like if you take the bike or a car, how to drive, which is a clutch, which is a gear, how they give the instruction, like EDA tool people have told us that if you use this blocking assignment operator, and if you use this assignment operator, so what impact we are going to provide in the synthesized output. If you synthesize, what you get, netlist you get. So in that, what we give? So we give, if you use this one, it is mostly preferred for combinational. Yes, mostly preferred for combination. You never should use this one for combination. If your intention is to describe combinational, then you should be using this one. You should be using this one. This is called blocking assignment operator, and you should be following the rule given by the EDA tool vendors. The 99% of the EDA vendors, they gave us the instruction that for building combinational circuit, Baba, you use this blocking assignment operator. And they also warned us not to use this blocking assignment operator for sequential circuit behavior development. If you want to develop JK flip-flop or T flip-flop, you may be getting simulation results, but they strictly warned not to use for sequential this blocking assignment operator. Industry also will not like you to develop a sequential network using this blocking assignment operator. Industry fellows also will not accept that. Now, this usage, if you come to this blocking assignment operator, strictly what is said is, you use this for sequential. Don't use this one for combinational development. It's combinational development. That is what the usage. I was emphasizing about the usage. Usage is, if you're developing any encoder, decoder, MUX, or whatever, combinational, as long as it is a combinational, your intention is to produce a combinational network, then you should use your blocking assignment operator. If your intention is to develop counter, flip-flop, shift registers, or whatever, sequential network, as long as it is sequential network, you should be using non-blocking assignment operator. So guys, this is the standard rule that we have to follow. Now let us move on to another part here. Now coming to this, so far we learned that there is a procedural construct called initial. There is another procedural construct called always. This is one thing that we learned, and this is used 99% in test benches, and this is used 99% in RTL development. That is another thing that we used, learned, and we also learned in this only we have to use for loop. We did not take this loop set. We'll discuss while loop, forever loop. So these loops we have to use within this initial or always only. And we have these statements called if, and the other is case. I'm going to the present now. I just lost the connectivity, some problem here. So, can someone unmute and tell what was the topic? Whether you people have seen this one, this case, case X, case Z?
No, sir.
Oh, then what was that last I was discussing?
The differentiation between blocking and non-block. So that's that differentiation also.
I said that EDA vendors strictly they impose the rule that we have to use for combinational blocking only. That you heard?
Yes, sir. And for a sequential also, you said like that.
Okay. That part is done, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, guys. Back here. After that, I moved to here. This I was telling that. Just a moment, let me clear this. So I was telling that we have so far we learned that there is a initial, there is a always. Two procedural constructs are there. This one we learned, and in this procedural constructs only we can use loops. So for example, for loop, while loop, forever loop. So such loops we can use only within always or within initial. That we said, but we did not take up the discussion about loops. This we will cover in the subsequent classes. And we also said that there is a if conditional statements like if, else if, so else if, and this is one. The other is case ready. This is a conditional, and this portion today we'll take up. So I was from here I moved to saying that in case we'll take the for discussion case. In case we have three types. One is normal case, the other is case X, the other is case Z. So this is all these three types of cases. We end with end case only. This case or case X or case Z, whatever it may be, we end with the end case only. This is the point that we have to note, especially new learners there. And just I'm checking whether we are here. I'm disconnected. Okay, we are there. Now, and we use this one here. This case we use being in initial or being in always. Why? Because the language rule compiler is so designed that within this only you can use the case or case X or case Z, all these three. You can use being in always or being in initial. you just cannot use without them, without always and without initial or without always. The usage of this case, case X, case Z or loops is not allowed. That's how the language is. Compiler is so designed. So now the point here is to remember the things here. We have three types of cases. One is case, case X, case Z. That is one thing. All these three types of cases will be ended with the end case. That is the second point that we have. The third point that we have is this. In case of case, here whatever that expression comes, that is compared with the, here the conditions. Here. Case expression, we call this one a case expression. And this is called case value. Case expression, if matched with the case value, and then syntax is colon, and whatever the statements that you thought of putting here, you can put, if there are multiple statements, you can use begin and end. Begin and end. Guys, they're especially new learners. What is that I'm telling? Case, open the parenthesis. And case expression. And corresponding to this case expression, what is the value to be you are looking for match? You may look for a match to occur 0. You may look for match to occur 1, for example. Anything that you're looking for that match to be. You put that match here and put a colon. And then what all the statements you thought of putting here under that particular case is met. Then you put them here. If multiple statements are there, then you use begin and end delimiters. This is one thing. The other thing is, can we have nested cases? Means yes. Within this begin and end, if you are looking for one more case to occur, that also you can put. And again, in that multiple statements also you can put. So that is also allowed. That is also possible. This is about the usage of the only case I'm talking. I did not touch this case except I did not touch a case Z yet. We'll see that later. So about this case like that, you proceed. And then once you have done with all cases, suppose if you have done with all cases, and if you want to put a default case, neither is happening. What is the default? That you can put a keyword called a default. You can use a keyword called a default. Use this default colon and whatever that you thought of putting statements to occur to be dealt by the compiler, then you put. And then finally, you use this end case. You don't be using here end as a separate word and a case as a separate word. Never use that. The way we have single word end module. What is the end module? End module put together, single word it is. You cannot have in a very long HCL end space module. So this is not correct. You have to have a single word end module. Likewise, having end case like that is incorrect. You have to have end case. So now, let us quickly go to this one. You have always, just a moment. For better understanding, let me take this. You have here, yes. Yes, size is, just a moment. So, yes, size is 2 bits. And you have here, 4 inputs. We have that I0, I1, I2, and then I3. And then you have one output. Now you are going to model this one, let us say this behavior. So you put always, and then add, and then this asterisk. That's it. It is according to 2000 point language standards. You know that we spoke a lot about what is 1995, what is 2001, and what is 2005. All those developments, previous sessions, we have seen a lot. So as part of that, it is very much permissible, this one. Now, I don't have multiple statements yet. This to model this one, I don't need multiple statements. I can do with only one case statement. The moment when I say one case statement, it's only one statement. That's the reason why I don't need begin and end. I can put here case. And now this case match expression is yes. This is the expression. This is the my case expression. This case expression here, it could be a 0, 0 or it could be a 1, 0, 1 or it could be 1, 0 or it could be 1. Them as a case value, I want to put here. I want to put them here as a case value. Now for that, what I do is, this case value I can put in a decimal form or that base format. You know the base format earlier we discussed, 2 tick B 0 0. This is the base format. 2 tick B 0 1. This is the base format. Without that also I can do. How I can do that without that? This is straight away decimal number. You can use decimal 0. Because this is the decimal equivalent 0, this is decimal equivalent 1, this is the decimal equivalent 2, this is the decimal equivalent 3. So 0, 1, 2, 3. You use them colon and colon, everywhere colon. This is the part of the syntax. Using a colon is a part of the syntax here. You have to use the colon here. Say colon here. Say colon here. No, not a comma here. Say colon here. Just a moment here. This is a colon here. Now, what you do here is, when this case expression is matching with the 0, what is that you look for? Why should get a value I not here? So, very obviously, Y is assigned with the I not. Similarly, you know, from here, very much, very, very obvious it is. When one is the, case expression when matches to one, then we see this I1 is assigned to Y. So every statement we have to close with a semicolon. That is a part of the syntax. So likewise, you complete all that. For example, let us say in this, if you have something like, you have, you take your AB, and you take your 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and you, this sum and carry. Now here it is 0, here it is 1, here it is 1, here it is 0, here it is 0, 0, 0, 1. Such a behavior is there now. How do you model this one? That is important one. Translate the behavior here. Case. So what should come here? Case expression should come. So what is that? This always when it should be triggered. When it should be triggered. That we have to put first. Always at whatever the input value. So for that we put this asterisk. This again 2005, 2005, 2001, everything we discussed. So here, this case, what is that you look for here? So obviously we look for when this match occurs, when this match is happening. So this two match should occur, right? So for that, you have one thing called, something called concatenation operator. These braces or curly brackets or flower brackets. Them you use them. They are acting like a concatenation. So the concatenation of it. So concat. So A and B. You are concatenating A and B. So you have clubbed them. Now after clubbing them put together, what you are seeing, whether that value is 0, 0, decimal equivalent is this, right? Decimal equivalent is the left side what I'm writing now. So either you can straight put them here, or this in a base format you can put here. That is 2 tick B 0 0. Now, if you see, observe carefully here, when you try to model, suppose say if you are trying to model here, this one, this behavior, this particular behavior, just a moment, this particular behavior. You see, for these two cases, so sum is 1 in both cases, and the carry is 0 in both cases, right? So such cases we can club actually. That is also one part to learn, that especially to the new learners there. We can club them instead writing twice. What we can do is, this is how to club 1, 2 in decimal format. If you are using 1, 2, this column syntax is part of the syntax is column. If you don't want to use this decimal, this side decimal, very much base format also you can use. What is that base format here? To tick B, this 0 1, to tick B 0 1, to tick B 1 0, colon is a syntax, colon. Now if you want to have a separate statement for sum and carry, then what you have to do is begin, and then sum is assigned with 1 semicolon, and then carry is assigned with 0. Since we have done with the statements here, now you can end this one here with the end keyword. This is one way of writing. The other way of writing is, you can concatenate them without begin and end. So without begin and end, to tick B 0 1, comma, to tick B 1 0, colon. Now concatenate. What is that concatenate? This sum and carry. So let us carry anyway, your order you can follow. So let us follow this order. So be careful while you assign the values here. So what is this decimal equivalent of this one here? If you see the order here, 0 1, right? So 0 1, no? So this is 1, basically 1. So 1 decimal value directly you can put. If you put directly decimal value, what it does, compiler converts this. Suppose say for example here you are putting something C naught sum. Now if you are assigning 5, let us say this is a scalar and this is also a scalar, meaning what? Scalar 1 bit, this is 1 bit, this is 1 bit. So maximum they can hold 2 bits only, right? So compiler, what it does for this 5, it converts, depending upon your operating system, a 32 bit equivalent or 64 bit equivalent, depending if your OS, this Verilla compiler will convert, depending upon your OS, the equivalent for this in the 32 bit equivalent or 64 bit equivalent. So in case, let us say 32 bit equivalent, so 101 is the actual equivalent, but all these values are appended with the zeros here, so that this fulfills like a 32 bit here. Now the assignment is done from the right side. Here. So what happens here is, assignment is done from the right side. So this right hand side one is assigned to this right hand side, extreme LSB. From LSB side, assignment is starting from the right hand side LSB. And then this 0 is assigned to this C0. This from 1, everything is discarded here. Is that clear? This point. Yeah. So that way, that's why here, those especially new learners, while you try to concatenate here without following this begin and end, if you want to concatenate, ensure that what is the value. Suppose if you are concatenating the other way around. The other way around means sum you have put first and then you are putting C naught. So yes, in that case, what possibly this is equivalent to in a decimal? It is equivalent to decimal 2, right? This 1 0. Then this is in a compiler will convert this to 0 1. So then your 0 is assigned to C naught and 1 is assigned to sum. So how you are putting while concatenating these identifiers, that a designer should be careful. So in order to avoid all sort of problems, it is advisable for the new learners to use it begin and end, and individually whatever the identifier is there you assign, instead of going to shortcut form like concatenating and assign. If you are not sure, then it is best practice. It is the best practice. So that is how this case is here. This always at asterisk case, case expression, and the case values. If multiple case values are pointing to the same statements like this in this case example, we can use them here together instead of writing multiple times here. These case values we can put separating with comma here. We can separate them with the comma case values, and a single statement will do for whenever this case is met or this case is met. The single statement is do will do, because this is what happening here in this functionality also. But if you see this one here, this is having separate, this case value is met, the C naught is different, and this is C naught is different. So we have to have possibly different case values here for this and for this. So with this said, either we are running out of time. So what I want to say, conclusion remarks are this, that so far we have covered, we try to learn Verilog HDL constructs. We emphasized on that. And from forthcoming classes, we have to more focus on coding, like hardware. How do you translate a different hardware you take? Maybe combinational, maybe sequential, maybe FSM, or maybe, as I said, total four I categorized. If you carefully focused, this is a combinational, this is a sequential, this is the finite state machines, this is a complex design wherein you include your data path plus control unit, data path unit DU plus control unit. So these are the complex. So our main agenda is we have to grow up to a level where we could be able to develop RTL for all these cases: combinational, sequential, FSM, and complex designs as well. In complex designs involves your data path unit plus control unit. So with that said, henceforth we more focus on RTL development, meaning translating this hardware functionality to the code now. So from subsequent classes, this week possibly we try to develop as many possible RTL examples, and also we try to wrap our this ongoing basic level Verilog HDL course. And before we wrap, because yesterday I couldn't able to continue my class because of the current power cut issue. That's why possibly Wednesday is not possible to wrap the session.